Today we're back to read Skin Deep, one of Arthur's requests for this month, which is a webcomic I reviewed several times in 2016 and 17. I thought it was a pretty decent offering, oh so long ago, so let's see if the same could be said for its next part, Illumination. For those who haven't watched my past reviews on the subject, Skin Deep tells the story of one Michelle Jocasta, a college student who discovers her lineage to an extinct species of cryptids. This inheritance then takes her down the rabbit hole of secret societies of not just her kind, but of demons, dragons, and even an angel that's trying to get her. So far, we're seeing how Michelle is adjusting to this new, dangerous life. Now, let's begin this 3-chapter-long story arc and see what happens next. We open in an underground cavern belonging to Jim's clan. He's bringing Michelle here to give an overview of his family, like Phineas the Red, who probably had red hair, whereas his family had a curse that changed it to green, or something to that extent. He might also be the guy who gives more details that are important to Michelle, because otherwise the trip has been a waste of time and money. I fail to see a difference. Well, of course you don't. You're like a leech. Anyway, Michelle gets a vision of Phineas by pressing her paw against the mural, but she couldn't really connect with it since things then feel a bit too garbled and cryptic. Jim then snaps her out of it and takes her to another point of interest. Meanwhile, the rest of their friends are just hanging around elsewhere in the household, with little brother Colin here expressing his excitement about going to a human school. He needs to be mindful of his manners, though. I don't think you'd be too excited to hear our opinions on growing up human anyways. It wasn't nearly exciting as your life. What? But you have thumbs! Oh, thumbs aren't a big deal. Sure, we can grab things with them, but wings are more awesome. You can fly with them, for crying out loud. Jim and Michelle finally return, and the latter is in a crabby mood. She's frustrated about not learning anything relevant today, which, fair enough. She then has to deal with Colin trying to get attention with his vocabulary. Damn straight.
Language.
Some more family members show up to present Colin his great-great-aunt's medallion. After touching it, he morphs into a human boy with blue hair. He's obviously thrilled with his transformation, what with him streaking through the house. But Jim is still mopey about the curse he still has. So he and the others head over to the Liverpool Avalon, where he runs into an old friend of his named Lorne. You might remember him from some of the side stories we covered. Michelle notices a shop named Ravi's House of Curiosities, and thinks that it could have the answers she's seeking. But Jim tries to talk her out of entering there. Why?
You found her. Oh, my darling Jimothy. I knew you would find her. Oh, thank the stars above, from across the seas even. Oh, they hit her deep, they did. But if anybody could unearth her, it would be one of my precious fins. This is why.
So he's a bit hammy. So what? I mean, sure, he could stand to not look so awkwardly at people he just met, even if he knows who they are, but still. In any case, he definitely seems to know what Michelle is after, especially after she mentions a dream about her father. Ravi then goes into exposition mode about a great war that seemingly wiped out all of the sphinxes. And he only knows this because he's a yaksha, a kind of nature spirit seen in Hindu, Jain, and Buddhist texts. Back on topic, Michelle learns that her late ancestor was trying to cover up the existence of the sphinxes with the help of someone named Washret. So it's possible there are still sphinxes in hiding. As for Jim, he finds out that Phineas was guarding something important inside the caves. It looks like a valuable phoenix egg. Or what's left of it. Ravi then gets rather upset over Jim not being the current guardian, since that position is only handed over to the eldest sibling in his family, in this case, Paul. This is in spite of Jim's talent with elemental magic, which his older brother lacks. So Ravi does him a solid by giving him an impromptu haircut. For you see, even his hair is capable of helping plants grow. Or is this magic that Ravi can just give, like he did with the rest of the family? Anyway, this old guy might finally have something on Phineas and the Finn family. But Colin butts in to show off a new present he has.
Mom and Dad got me a Game Boy because I have thumbs now. Silly kid, that's a Nintendo DS. Anyway, Colin has one of Ravi's gifts in the form of water magic, indicated by his blue hair. He even tries it out in a demonstration, so now he has yet another toy to mess with his older brothers. Everyone then gets over to the Finn house for further investigation, and here they find more secrets related to the Sphinxes. This convinces Ravi to take Michelle down to the caverns to explain all of it. While they do, Colin tries shifting into a mid-form but can't. Tobias feels mopey for some reason, and Jim tries teasing him for it. Just typical family stuff. Eventually, the mother of the family is getting impatient over the amount of time Michelle and Ravi are spending underground. But part one ends with Michelle returning with glowing eyes. And a ghost dog! Well, that was a pretty good cliffhanger. Let's see where this leads. Part 2 rewinds a bit with Michelle and Ravi, as well as the father of the family, going underground. There, they see a room being haunted by... Martha!
Why did you say that name?
Because that's the name of Ghost Dog. They're not sure how she's still around. Maybe she's sticking around to wait for her master. But in any case, they go through the door into the cavern, while Ravi provides more exposition. Apparently, he hasn't casted his gift of magic for 5 generations, and is upset that the family wasn't grateful about this favor, in spite of the fact that it just returned the moment he returned to this realm. He's also fuming about Phineas's irresponsibility. For a perky old guy, he has an incredibly short fuse. He and James then get into an argument over how this important information was lost so easily. The latter makes a good point about how Ravi has been cryptic all this time, and on top of his arrogance toward his past achievements, and those he considers to have screwed up. And he has the nerve to not notice they're angry? Anyway, Michelle asks more about the Phoenix Egg. She learns that they are used to create the magic medallions, and that maybe she can discover something by touching it. We'll get to what she finds out later, because now we shift over to Ravi being an idiot. He doesn't know if staying in the same country messes with his gift, so he shouldn't be calling the family he entrusted his powers to lazy. But at least he recognizes that he's being a fool here, and he apologizes to James. He admits to being ignorant about the consequences of leaving the world, and promises to stick around to help since he likes it here. So, okay, you get another chance. They eventually find a section of the cavern that Ravi once helped to build, and they eventually find the egg room, which is hidden behind a magic wall. And after more info dumping about the deaths and rebirths of phoenixes, Michelle gets her chance to touch the egg. She gets a vision of the medallion's creation, and of the dragon's attempt to secure them, which in turn might have led to the Great War. This experience then becomes more immersive than usual, as Michelle becomes one with her vision and finds herself experiencing the life of the original Jocasta member, along with Wasret. These two talk about the dragons killing off the medallion smiths, who were creating medallions for all the other cryptid species, and how they're flying blind without any news from the mainland. Other than that...
Who can it be knocking at my door?
Wasret, my good man. My good man! I was about to give up and go home!
Go away. Don't come down here no more.
So yeah, he's a mix of Jim and Colin. He likes drinking and is obsessed with thumbs. He wants to make them a medallion for a certain lion friend of his, but Wasret is refusing. Jocasta also seems to resemble Michelle, since she doesn't like sitting around, even when other people tell her to. She even agrees to help make the medallion in Wasret's place, but before we get more, the vision slowly fades from our view. Ravi adds to this experience by showing how sphinxes share power amongst each other, so the more of them there are, the less powerful everyone is. Therefore, since Michelle is the only Sphinx we know right now, it could mean that she is very, very powerful. So that might explain why the demons want her that badly. Depending on who uses her, she could easily overpower other magic users. Part 3 begins where Part 1 left off, with the group returning in time for dinner, while Michelle is still in a trance. Greg demands to know what happened, but Ravi tries to dodge the question by being super mysterious. He also tells everyone of Michelle's true power as she snaps back into the real world. She's got a lot to take in, but that can wait. Is it dinner time? She asks what we're all thinking. Yeah, are you really the head of the Quickie Mart?
Sorry. So while Michelle goes off to rest, Mary thinks of bringing this news with the elders, which James reluctantly agrees to. He gets on the phone while everyone is still worried about Michelle's condition. She's actually seeing into the past again, I think, and finds Jocasta being sassy with a satyr asking for medallions. He needs to wait for them like everyone else. At least her ancestor was the fun kind of character. Elsewhere in the Avalon, the elders meet up with each other, including one Madame New. They end up hosting James, Michelle, and Rabbi, as her main character is about to show her true form to them. Everyone's in disbelief, since sphinxes are supposed to be extinct, but Michelle also has a clearer picture of the vision we saw earlier. In this vision, we see that Jocasta and Washrit were summoned by someone who turned out to be a dragon. So she wanted medallions like everybody else, but Washrit doesn't want to help, since dragons were responsible for hunting down his kind. Jocasta is more open to helping, since it seems like this dragon has nothing to do with those events, but she then changes her mind when the dragon threatens her. I knew it! I knew it! The other said the British sphinxes were different from the rest of your wretched lot, but no! You are just as arrogant as the rest. In fairness, you weren't the picture of calm before your little freak out. If you were a little more restrained, they probably would have given you what you want. Instead, she fire breaths them before storming off. Back over to the present, because I guess there wasn't much else needed from the flashback. The rest of Michelle's friends wait outside the chamber anxiously. Greg really wants to be in there, but he wonders aloud if she even needs them anymore. The hell, dude? Of course she would. She might be onto something, but she's still going through a lot of stress. She'll probably want to hug you after everything is done here, so you better show up on time. As they all come out, Ravi explains the council's decision. It wants to keep Michelle safe in the Avalon for the time being. This makes sense, since it's the safest place to be from the demons and dragons. But this would put her life on hold and away from her loved ones. So unsurprisingly, everyone starts to bicker about what should be done. And it only ends when Michelle speaks up and admits that she's not sure what to do either. It's been such a stressful couple of days. Then we get another flashback. Jocasta was starting to think about giving the dragons what they want, but there's no time to think about that. The customer she denied burnt down their shop. Phineas also shows up with the phoenix egg he saved. But that's all we're gonna see. Back to the present! I'm not sure this jumping back and forth from past to present is a good way to tell the story, especially when that shift happens without warning. Anyway, Muriel is talking to Lorne about how they haven't seen Michelle or Greg in a while, but their conversation then turns to their own love lives. Muriel brings up how Jim likes Lorne so much, but he quickly shoots down that idea. He's already with someone else, or was, and Jim is also dating Muriel. And yet... Jim did this. This doesn't stop Muriel from encouraging him anyway. After all, if he expresses his feelings, he might reciprocate. And his response to this? Another phrase I heard people use for a collective noun is mythics. Back to the past vision, Jocasta notices that rebuilding isn't gonna do much, since the dragons are gonna come back and break everything again. Here is where Washrit comes up with the idea of faking the death of the sphinxes, and this is done by using the medallions to disguise themselves as the humans. Jocasta isn't too keen on this plan, since they don't know what would happen with these medallions working over multiple generations. But then the bird on Phineas' shoulder starts talking. Maybe it can build on what Washrit just proposed? This scene is familiar to Ravi, because as it turns out, he was that crow oh so long ago. But why a crow? I am whatever form I am, child. A Yaksha simply is. Whatever you say, old bastard. While he brags some more about how useful being a crow was, he says that he was called home because of his meddling in mortal affairs. But he decided to come back after seeing the family keeping the phoenix egg for so long, so he promises to stick around and help the two harness their powers. You just need to learn how to use your power. You must foster a strong connection to your prana. My what now? Why, that's the ability to bend reality to your own will. And if you have hands on the Millennium Cube, that effect can be even stronger. Right. I suppose it's more related to life energy in Sanskrit. Anyway, Ravi plans to help Jim control his magic powers better. Colin is also going to help because a kid with an open mind can serve as a template for an older magic user. Jim's not as interested, but he'll stick around so long as he has that plant hair. And there is one last flashback where Jocasta and Washrit go into hiding. They leave the phoenix egg to Ravi and Phineas, the former bestowing Phineas with the gift of magical fire and an obligatory red mane. Chapter 3 then ends with a scene between Greg and Michelle. They're down by the water, and she's all apprehensive about her next course of action. She vents about how there's so much she doesn't know and how every breakthrough she makes in her new life leads to more questions than answers. Greg also gets his chance to apologize for being too upset when she first transformed. It reminded him of his own insecurities and lack of good looks now that she gets to become prettier, but Michelle doesn't take offense. She happens to like Greg and is relieved that he is someone she can rely on, particularly during the bad times. So they share a nice kiss together, and off in the distance, we see Bloodcover slowly approaching. Well, that's concerning. Anyway, Illumination is another good chapter. After a lot of mystery and intrigue, we finally get to meaningfully connect the dots between the current moment and the past history of the Sphinxes. There's an overwhelming sense of weight in Michelle's discovery, that she's the last of her kind, that she has an unfathomable power, and that this birthright is going to make her a lot of enemies. It's a story that's very thick in flavor and world-building, but it doesn't forget to savor its character growth. Even after so many years away from this, I still love the cast from top to bottom. I don't agree with the placement of the past visions and flashbacks, but they didn't take away from the enjoyment I've had with learning about this interesting world. What the bad guys will do in the next chapter is up in the air, but if this ever gets requested again, I certainly will look forward to what they have in store for us. Next time, we'll be looking at something from the creator of Tintin. Hope to see you then. Who can it be now?